Hi all, welcome to our YouTube channel, and we are back again with the most important questions for Film 2020. Let's begin with the first question for today. Consider the following statement with reference to cool spots. Cool spots on the map show areas facing low threat to natural habitat. Second, these are vestiges of wild places where the world's threatened species can take refuge. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. A. Both. B. One only. C. None. D. Two only. So the correct answer here is A. Both. All right. Now, some of the cool spots that have been identified are parts of Amazon rainforest, Andes mountains, tundra, and boreal forest of Russia. Now, what exactly are these cool spots? Now, cool spots are where wildlife are actually thriving. Okay, and these cool spots exist along with hot spots where species richness is threatened by human activities. Alright, now the most impacted biomes include mangroves, tropical and subtropical moist broadleaf forest in southern Brazil, Malaysia and Indonesia, and tropical and subtropical dry broadleaf forest of India, Myanmar and Thailand. Alright, now the authors of this particular studies say that we need direct initiatives and direct future investment in conservation, all right, and also define various strategies to reduce the threat these particular cool spots and the hot spot areas are facing. All right, now moving on to the next question. Consider the following statements with reference to Global Snow Leopard and Ecosystem Protection Program. Now, the GSLEP is an intergovernmental alliance for the conservation of snow leopards and their valuable high mountain ecosystem. Now, the activities are grouped under broad themes that correspond to the commitments of Baishik Declaration. Now, snow leopards have been categorized as critically endangered in the IUCN Red List. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. A. 1 only. B. 3 only. C. 1 and 2 only. D. 2 and 3 only. So, the correct answer here is C. 1 and 2 only. Now, the reason your third statement is incorrect because snow leopards are actually categorized as vulnerable on the IUCN Red List. And this was in news because India for the very first time held the Global Snow Leopard and Ecosystem Program at New Delhi. Now, the snow leopard range countries and partners unanimously agreed in this meeting that there will be a shared goal of the GSLEP for 7 years through 2020, and the snow leopard range countries agree with support from interested organizations to work together to identify and secure at least 20 snow leopard landscapes across the CATS range by 2020. Okay, and also it is called as Secure 20 by 2020, in other words. Now, secure snow leopard landscape are basically defined as those that contain at least 100 breeding age snow leopard conserved with involvement of local communities, support and secure prey population, and also have a functional connectivity to other snow leopard range countries. Okay, and there should be a cross-border international agreement to protect these species. Now, please note that GLSP involves 12 snow range countries. Alright, now moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements are correct? First, invasive species show phenotypic plasticity, which is ability to adapt to new physical conditions in the habitats they have invaded. Second, invasive alien species are found in all taxonomic groups such as animals, plants, fungi and can affect all types of ecosystem. Third, Nagoya Protocol along with Aichi Targets of Convention on Biological Diversity aims to control their spread by 2022. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. A. 1, 2, 3. B. 3 only. C. 1 and 2 only. D. 2 and 3 only. Now, the correct answer here is C. 1 and 2 only. Now, the reason your third statement is incorrect because actually Nagoya Protocol is a fair and equitable sharing benefits arising from the utilization of genetic resources, thereby contributing to the conservation of sustainable use of biodiversity. It has nothing to do with the invasive alien species. All right, and so now what exactly does this say? So basically, an alien species is a species. An alien species is a species that is established outside of its natural past or present distribution, whose introduction or spread threaten biological diversity. Now, according to the IUCN, around 5 to 20% of alien species became invasive and is second most serious threat to biodiversity after global warming. So please note that. Now, recently, the National Conference on the Status of Invasive Alien Species in India was organized by the Zoological Survey of India and the Botanical Survey of India, in which the Zoological Survey announced a list involving 157 invasive alien species, out of which 58 are found on land and freshwater habitat and 99 are actually found in marine ecosystem. All right. And also an invasive species named charu mussel, which is native to South and Central American coast, is spreading quickly in the backwaters of Kerala. Hence, this was in news. Now, moving on to the next question. Consider the following statement. The basin of Brahmaputra River is a good example of braided river and meanders. Second, Dibang and Lohit are the major left bank tributary of this transboundary river. Third, the National Waterway 2 is a section of Brahmaputra River between the Bangladesh border near Dhubri and Sadia in Assam. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. A, 1, 2, 3, B, 3 only, C, 1 and 2 only, D, 2 and 3 only. So, the correct answer here is A, 1, 2, 3. All the statements here are correct, alright. Now, Brahmaputra is actually the 9th largest river in the world by discharge and the 15th longest river. It has origin in the Manasarovar Lake region near the Mount Kailash, located in the northern side of the Himalayas in Gurang country of Tibet, as Yarlung Tsangpo River, alright. The Brahmaputra name is actually given in India. Now, it takes a very sharp southwesterly turn along the eastern side of the Namcha Barwa mountain, where it forms a gorge. And also, Tsangpo is known as Dihang or Siang in Arunachal Pradesh. It enters west of Sadia in Arunachal Pradesh. And it receives its left bank tributaries. Now, please note these left bank tributaries are very important from prelims perspective. They are Dibang or Sikang and Lohit. Okay. And after that, it enters into the valley of Assam, where few more tributaries drain into it. Among them are Subansari, Jaibareli, Dhansari, then Manas. Okay, and here Brahmaputra forms a complex course where there are large riverine islands. Now, one of the very famous island is the Majuli Island, which is formed here. Okay, then it flows westwards up to the city of Dhubi, and thereafter it turns southward in the Garo Hills region and enters into Bangladesh near Golpara. And please note, it's called Jamuna in Bangladesh. Alright. Moving on to the next question that we have. Choose the correctly matched pairs. Mountain pass and road connectivity. Fotula, Srinagar Leh Highway, Rohtangla, Leh Manali Highway, Banihal, Jammu, Srinagar, Ghorghat, Khopoli and Khandala. Select the correct answer using the codes given below. A, 1, 2, 3, 4, B, 3 and 4 only, C, 1 and 2 only, D, 1, 2 and 3 only. So, the correct answer here is A, 1, 2, 3, 4. So, all the statements here are correct. Now, Fotula is a mountain pass on the Srinagar Leh Highway in the Zaskar range of Himalayas in India. And Fotula is also one of the two high mountain passes between Leh and Kargil. And the other one being the Namikala, okay? So just note this information. And Rohtangla is a high mountain pass on the eastern Pir Panjal range of Himalaya from Manali. It connects the Kullu Valley with the Lahore and Spiti Valley of Himachal Pradesh. Then the Banihal Pass is a mountain pass across the Pir Panjal range. It connects the Kashmir Valley in the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir to the outer Himalayas and plains to the south. Now, Ghorghat is a mountain passage between Pulsadhari and Khandala for railways, and between Khopoli and Khandala on road route in Maharashtra. Okay, which is situated on the actually the crest of your Western Ghats. So note this. Now moving on to the next question. Which of the following statement is correct with respect to revenue deficit? A. It is a gap between government's expenditure requirement and its receipts. Second, it indicates the receipt which leads to a decrease in asset or an increase in liabilities of the government. Third, in this, expenses are evaluated each time a budget is made and expenses must be justified for each new period. Fourth, none of the above. Now, the correct answer here is fourth, none of the above. Alright. Now, revenue deficit basically refers to the excesses of government's revenue expenditure over revenue receipts. Alright. The revenue deficit includes only such transactions that affect the current income and expenditure of the government. Now, when the government incurs revenue deficit, it implies that the government is dis-saving and it's using up its saving of the other sectors in the economy to finance a part of its consumption expenditure. Okay? So, if you were to say in it goes like revenue deficit is equals to revenue expenditure minus revenue receipts. Alright? So, please note that. Now, moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements are correct? Sea cow is the only existing species of herbivorous mammal which is vulnerable to extinction. Second, they are generally found in warm waters around the coast in shallow protected bays. Select the correct answer using the quotes given below. A. Both. B. One only. C. None. D. Two only. So, the correct answer here is A. Both. Alright? Both the statements are correct. Now, they are listed as vulnerable on the IUCN Red List and they are protected in India under the Schedule 1 of the Wildlife Protection Act of 1972. Now, according to a 2013 survey report of the Zoological Survey of India, there are only about 200 dugongs in the Gulf of Mannar in Tamil Nadu. Then we have the Andaman area. Alright? And we have the Nicobar Islands and the Gulf of Kutch in Gujarat. Now, the steps taken for the conservation is that in February 2020, India hosted the 13th Conference of Party of the Convention on the Conservation of Migratory Species of Wild Animals on Environmental Treaty under the aegis of this United Nations Environment Program. And the government is also a signatory to the CMS, alright, since 1983, and India has also signed a non-legally binding memorandum of understanding with CMN on the conservation and management of Siberian cranes, marine turtles, dugongs and raptors. So these are some of the initiatives that can be included in your mains answer. Alright, now moving on to the next question. Consider the following statement with reference to tribunals in India. A. Tribunal is a quasi-judicial body established in India by an act of parliament or state legislature. Second, they have to follow the procedures as laid down under the Civil Procedures Code of the Indian Evidence Act. Third, they are based on the recommendation of the Swaran Singh Committee. Which of the following statement are correct? A. One only. B. Two only. C. One and three only. D. Two and three only. So, the correct answer here is C, 1 and 3 only. Alright, now the statement 2 is incorrect. Because they do not follow the procedures as laid down under the Civil Procedure Code and the Indian Evidence Act, because they have to follow the principle of natural justice. Okay, now tribunal is a quasi-judicial institution that is set up to deal with problems such as resolving administrative or tax related disputes. It also performs a number of functions like adjudicating disputes, determining the rights between contesting parties, making an administrative decision, reviewing an existing administrative decision and so forth. Now, tribunals were part of the original constitution. Now, please note, this is an important piece of information that they were not not part of the original constitution. It was incorporated in the Indian constitution by the 42nd Amendment Act, alright? And Article 323A deals with administrative tribunal and Article 323 deals with tribunal for other matters. So basically we have two types of tribunals in India. So just note that. I'll repeat, they were added by the 42nd Amendment Act of 1976, and there are two tribunals, Article 323A, that is administrative tribunal, and Article 323B, which deals with tribunals for other matters. Alright, moving on to the next question. Which of the following statements are correct? Favi P. Ravir and Yumi Finovid will be tried as potential COVID-19 treatment strategy called FAITH. Second, this trial offers a comprehensive antiviral cover on pre-entry cycle of the SARS-CoV-2 virus. Now select the answers using the codes given below. A. Both. B. One only. C. None. D. Two only. So the correct answer here is A. Now both the statements are correct. So basically these two particular drugs will be used as a comprehensive antiviral cover on pre-entry and post-entry life cycles. Alright. Now these two antiviral drugs have very different mechanism of action, and their contribution may demonstrate improved treatment efficacy by effectively tracking the high viral loads in patient during the early stages of the disease. Alright. And this particular terminology will be used, FAITH, will be used under the Indian setting. Okay. Moving on to the last question. Kalamkari is a type of hand-painted or block-painted cotton textile produced in the state of West Bengal, Himachal Pradesh, Maharashtra, Fourth, none. Now, which of the following answer here are correct? So, the correct answer here is Fourth, none. Because Kalamkari is actually a type of hand-painted cotton textile which is found in the state of Andhra Pradesh and Telangana. Now, only natural dyes are used in Kalamkari, and it involves actually 23-step procedure. It's a very precise based method. Now, there are two distinct styles of Kalamkari art in India. We have the Sri Kalahasti style, and then we have the Machari Patnam style. Now, the Sri Kalahasti style of Kalamkari is where the kalam or the pen is actually used for freehand drawing and for the subject and filling of the colors, and it is entirely handwork. Then there are style like flowers around the temples and their patronage and so forth are used as a depiction in these particular textile clothing. Also, this style owes its status to the Kamala Devi Chattopadhyay, or who actually popularized this particular art, and she is also the first chairperson of the All India Handicraft Board. Alright, so that's it for the day, and for more information on our various courses, please visit our website www.ahs.com, and for more such information, like, share, subscribe to our YouTube channel. Thank you.